Good morning and happy Sabbath to each of you. We're glad you're able to join us for this virtual Sabbath celebration. This morning, you may be watching us on your phone, on your tablet. You may be watching on your computer monitor or your TV screen. Some of you may be meeting in your living room with your children gathered around you. Others may be meeting alone in your home. No matter where you are, whether you're in the northern part of the state or living right here in Indianapolis or in the southern part of our conference, we welcome you. We are glad to be able to be connected together across the field for this special worship service. Friends, as you know, we are living in some very troubling times. Our world has changed so dramatically in the last few weeks. Who would have ever imagined just 3 months ago that we would be in the situation that we're in right now? Our world is facing a global pandemic, and there really is no clear indication of where things will be and how long this crisis will be. There are many watching right now who have been drastically affected by the COVID-19 crisis. Many of us are meeting in our homes. We're respecting the mandate of our governor. Churches have closed, schools have closed, businesses have closed, our workplaces have closed. And we're not really clear of how long these mandates will last. Who knows, we may be meeting for virtual church and Sabbath school for several weeks still in the future. If you are a health professional and you're on the front lines of this battle, we just want to express appreciation for all that you're doing to help people who are sick. Please know that there are many of us across this conference who are praying for you that God will give you strength and wisdom to know what to do in this time of crisis. We also want to express our appreciation to all the pastors and all the teachers and all the ministry leaders who are stepping up and working in this new environment. Many are demonstrating strong spiritual leadership at this time. We are hearing exciting reports of ministry taking place. We're hearing how individuals are stepping up and learning new technologies that they've never known before. We're hearing how members are connecting with other members through Instagram and Facebook and Zoom and YouTube and other ways of meeting virtually in small groups throughout the week. We're also hearing reports of how members are reaching out to the elderly in their congregation to see what needs they may have. We just praise God for all the ministries that are taking place. This is church in action, and many are doing things that perhaps they were not doing before. As we go through this crisis, how do we respond? How do we relate as Seventh-day Adventists living in these final days of Earth's history? Well, friends, this should not surprise us. We are going through a crisis, but Jesus predicted this in Matthew 24. He gave signs that would take place just before his return. He said there'd be earthquakes, there'd be floods, there'd be disasters, there'd be pestilences in various places. And he said all of these are the beginning of sorrows. So we're seeing these, and we could expect many more things to happen just prior to the coming of Jesus. So we're not surprised by these things, but yet when we see these developing upon the earth, it does bring concern and fear to our hearts and wondering where things will go in the future. Well, we have some assurances in God's word that we don't have to allow the fear to paralyze us from keeping our faith and trust in God. I love this passage in Isaiah chapter 41. This is in verse 10. These are the words of God himself. Isaiah is writing. It says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." I love these words because it reminds us that our God is in control. Friends, this crisis did not catch God by surprise. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He knows the end from the beginning. And this powerful, all-knowing God, the one who holds the world in his hands, he has told us in his word that he will uphold us with his righteous right hand. He will take care of us. He will help us in our time of need. I am thankful that we have nothing to fear. With God on our side, nothing will keep us away from that love that he will provide for us. He says, "I will never leave you or forsake you. I will be with you always into the end of the age. I am very thankful that the General Conference has continued the 100-day prayer focus. Of course, they were planning to do this 100 days leading up to the General Conference session. And as you've heard, the General Conference session has been postponed now until May of next year. What I'm grateful for is that that could have ended. That prayer focus could have ended. It could have said, well, we're not doing the meetings or the session anymore, but they have kept with it. And they are in this prayer focus all around the world. And friends, if there's ever a time to pray, if there's ever a time to seek after God and His help, it is now. We need to be praying for the government officials. We need to be praying for the health professionals. We need to be praying for our members and our churches who are being affected in dramatic ways by this virus, this crisis that we're in. We need to be praying for our church leaders as they're making difficult decisions as we move forward. And in addition to all of these, we also need to be praying for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. If anything is going to happen in these final days, it will be because of the movement of the Holy Spirit upon God's people. We need to be praying for the latter rain power to be poured out so that we can continue to press on and do God's work in the final days in which we live. Friends, we still have a mission to accomplish. We still have work to do, and we're praying that God will bring a revival among His people so that we can do the final work and go and be home with Jesus someday soon. Christ is coming, and let us be ready for His soon return. So in the studio right now here with me, we have Pastor Rob. Pastor Rob is the pastor of the Carmel Church, and he is also the evangelism coordinator for our conference. Rob, we're really excited about what God is doing. It seems that a lot of doors were closing, but God was working behind the scenes in preparing for what was coming. And with a lot of conversation, with It Is Written television ministry, and with a lot of prayer, God has opened up some amazing doors to be able to reach many people, not only just in Indiana, but all across the state. So maybe tell our members what has happened and where we're going in the next few weeks.
Sure, Vic. You know, the Apostle Paul, in talking to the Corinthians and explaining why he wasn't going to be with them immediately, but was going to stay in Ephesus for a while, he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 9, "For a great door and effectual," that means a great door of opportunity, a great door of work or labor, Paul said, "has opened unto me," there in Ephesus. And he said, and there are many adversaries. You know, it's interesting that for Paul, as he was spreading the gospel in the first century, he looked for circumstances. He looked for providential situations that would indicate where he should focus his energy, his attention, his effort at any given time. And for Paul, one indicator that God was working in a special way in a certain place was the presence of great opposition. Lots of obstacles, lots of hindrances to what Paul was trying to do. And we can really identify with Paul, because our well-laid plans for Ignite Indiana have met with great opposition in the last few weeks in the form of a viral pandemic that has shut down every evangelistic meeting that we plan to hold in Indiana this spring, every single one. We had reserved venues to seat hundreds of people, and now we can't meet in groups any larger than 10. And so there's a lot of opposition. There's a lot of obstacles in our way. But we want to say with Paul, God has opened unto us a great door of opportunity, and He has, in four significant ways. First of all, with modern technology, we can now do one large online virtual evangelistic series that will make our message accessible to just about every resident in our conference in the state of Indiana at the same time, which means that we're going to find interests near your church and in faraway places far from where we had planned to preach. And we never would have known about these people if this crisis hadn't come at this time as it has. Secondly, we had planned to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on Ignite Indiana, but now those costs have been reduced to just tens of thousands at the most. You think about it, we don't have any venues to rent. We can't send out handbills today like we planned, and that's going to save us a lot of money, a lot of the Lord's funds, and we praise God for that. In addition, now we can send online ads. We can send digital advertisements that will land in people's mailboxes, virtual mailboxes, not just once, but we can send them every single day leading up to the series when it begins. And we can send a variety of ads. We can send all different kinds of advertisements, ad content, videos that will reach a lot of different audiences than we would have reached with one single handbill. And speaking of audiences, number three, we pretty much have a captive audience today when you think about it. Social distancing guidelines have shut down all but the most essential businesses, which means that people can't go to sporting events, they can't go to theaters, they can't go to restaurants and bars or fitness centers, they can't even go to churches. And that means that many people are going to be at home and available to watch Revelation Today, Hope Awakens, with John Bradshaw, speaker director for It Is Written, as he brings the gospel and the three angels' messages right into their homes. And you know, it's looking likely that people are going to be in their homes for the entire 4 weeks of the series. It begins April 17th and it ends on May 16th. And that means that we have an opportunity here. If something like this had to happen, it couldn't have happened for us and for the gospel at a better time. And number four, you, our church members, now have an opportunity to become what we're calling virtual Bible workers, which means that you can interact with interest and visitors that are watching the online series, Revelation Today, from the privacy of your home, from the comfort of your home and the convenience of your own home using your computer or an iPad or a telephone. And that means that many more of us in the Indiana Conference than we had anticipated can be directly involved in soul-winning efforts. And so, yes, there's opposition, but praise God, He has opened a great door of opportunity for us. One door has closed, another door has opened. God is working through these circumstances. And I say, let's go through this open door together with our It Is Written partners and see what God will do. We want you to attend this online series every night if possible. We want you to pray for this series every day in your personal and your family worship time. And we want you to seriously consider being one of our virtual Bible workers so that you can get involved and we can see what God can do through all of us at this critical time in Earth's history.
Rob, it's pretty amazing to see what God is doing. Clearly, where one door closed, God clearly opened up a bigger door than what we ever dreamed of.
Amen.
And so I'm excited. And I think that there are many that are watching, many members across our conference who were very eager, very excited about Ignite Indiana and all these meetings coming up. And I know that many of us were wondering as the doors were closing, God, why is this happening? And where do we go from here? Because this is your work and you're in charge. And we believe that there's a mission still accomplished. And so I know many want to know, how can I personally be involved? What can I do? So maybe you can say it one more time before we end. When did the meeting start? How many nights a week is it? And how can they get connected to this series?
Yes, good question. So mark your calendar. The series begins April 17th at 7 o'clock. It's a Friday night. The platform will be hopeawakens.com. So you want to write that down, hopeawakens.com. Starts April 17th, 7 o'clock. And the series will run Friday, Saturday, Tuesday, and Wednesday nights through May 16th. When you see these ads from It Is Written coming up on your virtual platforms, your social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Google, be sure you click on those ads. Be sure you like those ads and share those ads with others. And also, you'll want to register as a viewer as soon as possible when you get to the on the platform there, the landing page, and you can register as a participant. And we want you to do that as soon as possible.
You know, as you were talking, I was thinking that there are a lot of friends that I have their emails, I have their contact lists, And I'm thinking how I can notify them about these meetings. So it's not just people down the street or people that I work with, but I have family and friends that are all across the country. And I can invite them to join in because they can watch it on their phone, on their tablet, right from their own home. If they live in California, if they live down in Florida, they can be part of these meetings. So please be mindful and begin to think about who you may be able to invite to this series that is coming up. And maybe during this time that they're more open than they've been, because this crisis has softened many hearts. And there are many people who have questions. What is happening? Where is all this heading? And so this series will be able to answer those questions and many more from the Bible. So, Rob, thank you for sharing. We're so excited. We believe God is moving in mighty ways. And so at this time, we're going to transition. I've asked Mark Eaton, our treasurer and secretary of the conference, to share a few words on tithe and offering.
Good morning, church members. What a time we live in. Who would have thought 4 months ago we'd be going through what we're going through now? But it reminds me that God's people have been through trouble before. And I think of the time of Elijah. Remember that story in 1 Kings chapter 17? He called down a drought. His water ran out. So he went to Sidon, where a widow was to take care of him. So he rose and went to that city, and he met the widow. She was gathering sticks. And he called out to her and said, "Bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink." And as she turned to get him some water, he called out again and said, "And bring me a little bit of bread, a morsel of bread in your hand." Listen to what she said. She says, "As the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin, a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat and die." Oh, can you imagine? What a desperate situation. She thought that she was going to starve to death. But notice what Elijah says in verse 13. He says, "Do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but bake me a small cake from it first and bring it to me, and afterwards some for yourself and your son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor the jar of oil run dry, until the Lord brings rain upon the earth." And what did she do? She believed the word of the Lord. Now, there's many things you could say about this story, but the main point that stands out to me is that she put God first. What would have happened if she had hoarded that last little bit of oil, that last little bit of flour? She might have starved, but she believed the word of God, and he provided for her. In the year 2000, I returned to the United States after serving 16 years in overseas as a missionary. And I came back to be treasurer of the conference in West Virginia. It's called the Mountain View Conference. But after 6 months, one of my daughters became very sick. And she required multiple hospitalizations. It was a very, very sad and trying experience. But what made it even more stressful was that my insurance only paid for 2 weeks. So I was piling up hospital bills. One time, her illness was so bad that they sent her to the University of West Virginia Medical Center in Morgantown, which was the best hospital in the state. And I'll never forget, the medical director came to me and said, "Mr. Eaton, your daughter will have to be hospitalized for 6 months. Well, I counted up that cost very quickly, and it was between $150,000 and $180,000. I was panicked. I thought, I'll have to declare bankruptcy. And I wonder what the church members would think, a treasurer declaring bankruptcy. Well, as I was thinking about this, as I was gripped with fear, a thought came to my mind. It's found in Malachi 3:10, the last part. It says, "Try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out such a blessing, there shall not be room enough to receive it." Now, the medical director was an older lady, and she was not very friendly. She had a kind of a stern look about her. And to me, she seemed very negative, especially to me. And I dreaded talking to her, but I didn't have a choice. I explained to her that I had a modest salary and I could never pay for this bill. And I'll never forget, I watched her and her expression on her face softened. She paused and then she picked up the phone and she made a call to the Department of Health in Charleston, West Virginia, the capital. She asked to speak to the director, the health director. They started to talk, and I could tell they knew each other. They were on first name basis because the medical director was very well known throughout the government. The medical director explained to the health director my daughter's problem and my financial problem. And the health director said, "I'll call you back." 10 minutes later, the phone rang. The medical director picked up the phone. Sure enough, it was the health director. The health director informed the medical director that West Virginia had a small fund, to care for children who had the kind of sickness that my daughter had. They had enough for about 3 or 4 children every year. And they were authorizing and paying for the care of my daughter for 6 months. You know, folks, we live in troubled times, but no matter what the circumstances, it's always best to put God first. And during these troubled times, I encourage you, keep being faithful. Put God first. Give your tithes and offerings as you always have, according to your income. Now, there's several ways you can do this. Most of our churches now have online giving. So you can go to the website, create an account, and you can pay your tithe and your offering. If the church doesn't have a website, you can always go to the conference website. They have Indiana Conference has a page for online giving. Or, if you prefer, you can just write a check and send it to your church. The churches will have somebody picking up the mail and making deposits. Isaiah 33:16 is one of my favorite texts, and especially applies to this time. In Isaiah 33:16, the Lord is addressing people who are faithful. And it says this: "He shall dwell on high. His place of defense will be the fortress of rocks. Bread will be given to him. His water will be sure." Folks, if we put God first, He will do for us what He did to that widow, and He will supply your needs. God bless you.
Blessings. We pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing and prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need, yet love us way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know your name? What if trials of this life how your mercy's in disguise. We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry out in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear each desperate plea, you long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know this pain reminds our hearts that this is not, no, this is not our home. It's not our. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments are the aching of this life, is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? What if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, how your mercy's in disguise?
So at this time, I'd like to just say a special word of appreciation to Pastor John and his team at the It Is Written Ministries. We're thankful for the work that they've been doing and the partnership that we've been in. We especially appreciate Jack Phillips, the Bible worker for It Is Written. He has done a lot of training in our field. And we know that many all across this state have appreciated the ministry of John and his team. And so John comes with a heart for evangelism. We believe that God has a message that he has placed on John's heart to share with us this morning. So Pastor John, I know you're preaching from the studio there in Chattanooga. Thank you for being with us this Sabbath, and may the Lord bless the message that you'll be sharing with us today.
Well, this isn't what we expected, was it? But that's okay. Thank you for joining me in my office at It Is Written. I think we're going to have a good time as we open the Bible together. Happy Sabbath. Good morning, if it's still morning. I hope you're well and blessed and encouraged in the Lord. And I'm grateful to the leadership of the Indiana Conference for giving me the opportunity to speak with you and share God's word with you. These are exciting times, and I'm encouraged by the example given to us by the Indiana Conference leaders. They're about evangelism, about growing the kingdom of God. They're about sharing Jesus with others. And that excites me. Well, let's just pray and begin, shall we? We'll go to the Bible. and we'll see what the Bible says. I believe that God has a message that's going to encourage us today. Let's pray together now. Our Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we come to you. We ask your blessing. We seek your face. We pray, pour out your spirit and speak to us. In Jesus' name, please say with me, amen and amen. A family had been planning a vacation in Florida for some time. They were going to travel to the Florida coast, the Gulf Coast. And they were looking forward to taking the kids and being at the beach and having a great time. And they loaded up and they knew they needed the vacation and the kids would enjoy it. And they hit the road with a great sense of relief. And they arrived on the Gulf Coast in Florida without a lot of relief. And here's why. They arrived in Florida and discovered that the beach had been afflicted by red tide. Let me see. Should I adjust this a little bit? Yeah, a little bit. There we go. Red tide. Adjust my tide. Red tide. Now, you know what red tide is? It's caused by something so small that you can't even see it. Does that sound familiar? Little wee things called phytoplanktons. And I wrote down what they are. They are photosynthesizing microscopic biotic organisms, not bionic, biotic. You can't see them for the most part. You could never see them with unaided, but they can be deadly. They can kill fish, even dolphins. They get into shellfish and they affect the shellfish so that people are told not to eat them, which I think is always pretty good advice. Our family, not our family, but the family in the story, and it was not mine, went to Florida hoping to swim, but couldn't swim. The smell was overwhelming. The eyes hurt. Couldn't go in the water. Things changed. And their big plans were dashed. Sound familiar? You've had your hopes dashed before. You hoped that you could go to the senior banquet with him or her, but someone beat you to it. And your hopes were dashed. You were hoping to go home for Thanksgiving and spend that with mom and dad or grandma and grandpa, but something happened and you weren't able to do so, and that was too bad. What else? You might have wanted to, I don't know, go to some event or another. Something happened. You didn't get the job that you were hoping to get. You had great expectations, and it just didn't work out. But what about this? The novel coronavirus struck, and people couldn't have their weddings or attend weddings. Funerals were postponed. Graduations were postponed. School was called off. The Olympic Games couldn't go ahead. Wimbledon was canceled for the year. The baseball season's not going to get underway. Maybe it'll never start at all. Basketball season was called off. All of these tremendous changes, you know, because of the novel coronavirus. Many people were disappointed. General conference session was called off in your backyard. Many people from around the world that had their plans changed and their expectations dashed. But you know, there are times in life when life hands you a lemon and you instead make lemon basil spritzer. That's what you do. You turn this thing around. An opportunity comes out of something that was disappointing. Aren't you glad God was in control? For the longest time, we'd been planning meetings with you in Indianapolis. Many meetings were going to take place around the great state of Indiana. And we had been working with wonderful people. So thankful for Jack Phillips and his team of Bible workers in Indianapolis. Our good friends at the conference office, church leaders and pastors and so many wonderful folks that we were interacting with. And then the coronavirus came. Oh my. Well, what happened then? Smaller than phytoplankton, invisible to the human eye, a coronavirus dashed our plans. And instead of nothing happening, something even bigger, something even greater is going to come. God took our disappointment and turned it around and said, no, you don't have to stop. You can just go ahead and it's going to be fantastic. The Bible is a book that deals with expectations that were dashed and then turned around so that God brought something wonderful out of it. Now, you're expecting me to talk about 1844. Daniel chapter 8, verse 14. You might be expecting me to talk about Revelation chapter 10. Ah, but no, that would be too predictable. There are other times in the Bible, many of them, where there were great expectations. Things didn't turn out the way people hoped, but God turned it around for his glory, for his glory. Let's look at three or maybe four examples of that. We'll begin in 2 Kings chapter 4, starting in verse 1. A woman that you've heard about, a widow as a matter of fact. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1. Watch God turn things around. Things didn't play out exactly as folks expected. Instead, God did something greater. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1. Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha, saying, "Thy servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that thy servant did fear the Lord. The creditor is come to take unto him my two sons to be bondmen, to be slaves. Husband died. I've lost him, and now I'm going to lose my sons. Here comes the creditor." Elisha said, "What shall I do for you?" And then he asked her a question. "Tell me, what do you have in your house?" And she said, "Your handmaid doesn't have anything at all, except for a pot of oil." Verse 3. Then he said, "All right, go borrow the vessels abroad of thy neighbors, even empty vessels. Don't borrow just a few. Go and get as many of these things as you can." This was stockpiling before stockpiling was fashionable, you understand. And now in verse 4, it says, the prophet still speaking, "And when you are come in, you shall shut the door upon you and upon your sons, and shall pour out into all those vessels and set aside that which is full." She thought, "Oh, wait a minute. I was looking forward to a happy life. I was looking forward to something wonderful, but my husband died, and they're going to take away my sons." My expectations were dashed. And financially, she was facing absolute ruin. How would a widow lady be able to look after herself? You know something, my friend? God sees it coming to you before you do. And God has 1,000 ways to provide for you, of which you know nothing at all. God knows. You might not, but God knows. And then the Bible says in verse 5, "So she went from him and shut the door upon her and upon her sons who brought the vessels to her." Imagine this faith. "Have a little bit of oil, and he's asking me to tip it out. What a fool I'll feel like if now I have the same amount of oil in a great big pot. But I'll do it anyway. I have so little, but I'll pour it out." You might say, we might say ourselves sometimes, "I am so little, but I'll pour myself out. I don't have much to give to the Lord. I'm digging in my pocket. I just got coins rattling around. I'll set aside for God that which God places on my heart to set aside." And then great, great, great things happened. She poured out the oil. And then what? "It came to pass when the vessels were full that she said to her son, 'Bring me yet a vessel. Bring me another one.' And he said to her, 'There is not a vessel more.' And the oil stayed. It stopped flowing. Then she came and she told the man of God. And he said, 'Go, sell the oil, pay the debt, and live thou and thy children of the rest.'" Now, she was facing financial ruin. Her plans for her life had been dashed. Everything had gone down the drain. But God brought something wonderful out of it. Yes, she was still without her husband. But if she hadn't lost her husband, she would not have lived to see God work this amazing miracle. And we wouldn't have either. So she went through a hard time. I'm not denying that the time she went through was difficult. It was difficult. No one wants to go through that. But she went through the difficulty, and God did something incredible that she saw and we see today. God brought something wonderful out of her dashed hopes. Financially, she was ruined. Emotionally, she was traumatized. She was living on the very edge. "I'm about to lose everything, even my boys. It'll be a death sentence. How can I fend for myself?" And God worked for her in amazing ways. She had money. She had money to spare. Her neighbors said, "God has done great things for her. She borrowed my jar, my empty jar. What do you want them for? Don't you worry about that now. Just let me have what I'm asking for, and God is going to do something great." Listen, friend, when your expectations are crushed or dashed or damaged or some way harmed, don't think that God has forgotten about you. Our extremity is God's opportunity. We are seeing that right now with Revelation Today, Hope Awakens. We are still starting on April 17 in Carmel and in Indianapolis and in Anderson and in any town or city in Indiana that you care to name. It got bigger. Let's use this opportunity. How disappointing for me to know I'm not coming to Indianapolis. I'm not going to be there and see the whites of your eyes and shake folks' hands and witness hearts changing under the aegis of the Holy Spirit. But now God's doing something bigger. It wasn't my plan. It was God's plan, you see. God is good. We're just going to hang on to God and let him do what he wants to do. And when this is over, we are going to say, great is thy faithfulness. Well, now, there are some things that you don't want canceled. Imagine if your baptism had been canceled. Imagine if your birthday party was canceled. Imagine if your wedding was canceled. Imagine if you had a vacation that you'd been looking forward to and it was canceled. But there are some things that you wish could be canceled. What about a funeral? Wouldn't you like to cancel that? We don't need to have the funeral anymore because the person is not dead, but alive. Well, you never heard of that happening. Oh, wait. Yes, you did. And it's in the Bible. And we're looking now in Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7, and we'll begin in verse 11. The word of God says in Luke 7, verse 11, it came to pass the day after that he went into a city called Nain. And many of his disciples went with him and much people. This really happened. Now, when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And much people of the city was with her. So again, she was facing financial ruin. Her only son, he wouldn't be there to provide for her. What would happen to her in her old age? And now emotionally, she's stretched, she's broken. She's gone through trauma. She's lost her beloved son. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and he said to her, weep not. Jesus comes to her and he says, don't cry. Well, you might think, what? Without some context here, without a little additional information, she's just going to think that Jesus is mocking her. Don't cry. And he came and he touched the bier, the cortege. He came and touched the platform, the carriage upon which the deceased lay. And they that carried him, bare him, stood still. And he said, young man, I say to thee, arise. Now, you know what I like about this? We're talking about what to us is impossible. Impossible. God can't bring something good out of this unless the resurrection takes place. Accepting the resurrection, my heart is going to be broken, and there's nothing that can soothe my broken heart. Ah, come on now. It might seem impossible for you, but nothing is impossible for God. How are we going to reach the people of Indiana, the saints in Indianapolis? What are we going to do? Well, we're going to praise the Lord because he's got it worked out. And God is the difference between impossible and possible. What happened next? He that was dead sat up. And they wondered, what? But he began to speak. And he, Jesus, delivered him, the young man who had been dead, to his mother. And there came a fear on all. And they glorified God, saying, that a great prophet has risen up among us, that God has visited his people. Oh, yes, God had visited his people. Listen, if that woman had not gone through that hardship, she would not have seen the glory of God revealed in that fashion. If she had not lost her son, thank God it was only temporary. She wouldn't have seen God do great things. This is true in our lives. I'm not just talking about the evangelistic meetings. It's true in our lives that we are disappointed sometimes. But without that disappointment, we would never have seen the glory and the goodness of God. Without being stretched out in prayer, without being in a financial pinch, we wouldn't have seen God come through in that way. Without being so ill, we wouldn't have experienced the dramatic healing that God brought to us. So praise the Lord anyway. Praise the Lord in your trials, because God is getting ready to do something big in the middle of your difficulties. God is getting ready to do something big in Indianapolis and throughout the state of Indiana. And if God wasn't doing it this way, he'd find another way, because you can do nothing against the truth, but for the truth. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness to all nations, and then shall the end come. Amen and hallelujah. God has got it worked out. Now, there's another time disappointment was turned into ecstasy, into great joy. I want you to turn with me in your Bible, just back a couple of chapters, to Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5. And so we're reading in Luke 5, and we're starting in verse 4. Now, when he had left speaking, that's Jesus, he said, Simon Peter, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught, for a catch of fish. And Simon answering said to him, Master, we've toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Now that's faith. It doesn't even make any sense to me, but because you have said so, I'm going to do it. It doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem likely, but because God spoke, because Jesus said something, I'll act on what he said. That is faith, acting on what God says. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fish, and their net broke before, no fish, nowhere. And now so many fish, the net cannot take the strain. What a dramatic turnaround. Imagine this, it's your livelihood. You're a cab driver, you've been out all night and haven't got a fare. You're a food delivery guy or girl with DoorDash, and nobody has said, hey, deliver me some food. Imagine that. You're a salesperson, you're making calls, and nobody has taken you up on your offer. What in the world? No income. You're a literature evangelist, and it seems like you're not making any sales. Well, God's got it all figured out. There are so many fish that under the direction of God, your net might break. What do we read here? They beckoned, verse 7, unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both of the ships, so much so that they began to sink. Imagine, and I don't want you to accuse me of engaging in hyperbole here, but imagine in our extremity that we start to pray to God and we start to work with God and we start to appeal to the Spirit of God and we share our faith, and suddenly there are so many people coming to our church, we've said, there's got to be something wrong here. There are so many people accepting Bible studies, we are saying, what? This doesn't seem to make sense. It didn't make sense that they would go from catching nothing to catching enough fish to sink two ships. But this is what God can do. He can turn things around for you. It's what he does. It's what he does. A poor lady has nothing, so much oil. She became an oil merchant. A dear lady loses her son. He's dead. And what happens? He is brought back to life by the one who was the way, the truth, and the life. And now they'd fished all night. They hadn't caught a thing. It was going to be a slow day at the market, for they had nothing to sell. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, fear not. From henceforth you shall catch men. How do you like that? And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. This was so dramatic that it was a life-altering event, and they made a life-changing decision. I will be a follower of God. Look, here was somebody who was not a disciple of Christ yet, and he had a disappointing night. And the next day, God did something like that. That was so dramatic. It filled up their boats, broke their nets, made them a ton of money, and they decided, this is so powerful, I am now becoming a disciple of Jesus Christ. Sometimes your disappointments will grow your faith. Sometimes your disappointments are simply God's way of saying, if you'll hang on tight, I'll do something spectacular. There's another example I want to share with you, and it's found in Luke chapter 24, same book. Luke 24, and we begin in verse 13, and I'm probably not going to read this entire passage because it's 20 or so verses. Behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was about 60 furlongs from Jerusalem is about 7 miles. Would that be right? A furlong is about 200 meters, 60 of them, 12,000, 12 kilometers. It's about 7 miles. It came to pass while they were communing together and reasoning, Jesus came near, went with them. They didn't know it was Jesus. He said, what manner of communications are these that you're having? You walk and you are sad. And one of them said, Cleopas, are you a stranger? Do you not know what's gone on in Jerusalem lately? I wonder if Jesus looked at his hand and saw the scar and said, you know, I have a fair idea. Did he say that within himself? Yeah, funny they should say that, but I know better than them. Jesus said, what things? And they said, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet mighty indeed and word before God and all the people. Look in verse 21. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. We thought he was the Messiah. Man, were we disappointed. We thought he was the deliverer. You all have a disappointment because you cannot go to the Olympic Games. You have a disappointment because the general conference session has been called up. You have a disappointment because there are no Wimbledon or no motor racing or whatever it might be. Oh, sure, disappointment. Did you ever have a disappointment that said, we thought he was the Messiah. We trusted in Jesus, but oh, were we wrong? Think of that kind of disappointment. And Jesus was merciful. They went ahead and walked through what happened that Friday night, that Sunday morning. When they found not his body, they came saying they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Clearly, well, it appears they didn't believe he was very alive. Jesus said, oh, fools, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and enter into his glory? Hey, let me share this with you. Jesus was saying to them, you know, the prophecy said this. Jesus was saying to them, didn't I tell you? Didn't I tell you? I'm going to go down there. They're going to kill me. Peter rears up on his hind legs. It shall not happen. This is when Jesus has to say, get thee behind me, Satan. He told them and told them and told them and told them, I'm going to go down there. They'll treat me badly. I will die. They read Isaiah 53, and I'm guaranteeing you that Jesus read that scripture to them in a Bible study one night. Got the wheels in their minds turning. And it happened. And when it happened, they were disappointed. Have you read Matthew chapter 24? Yes. Have you read Luke 21? Same information, basically. Yes. What does it say? It says famines, wars, rumors of wars. It says that. It says pestilences. And now that it's happened, why are we saying, why are we doing that? We look like the character in the Edvard Munch painting Scream. Have you seen that? Why aren't we saying, we were told this was going to happen. Jesus said it would happen. We read in the red books, this was going to happen. I'm not saying that we should grab hold of this with joy, but we might want to say, well, I do mean that we should hold on to it with joy. But I'm not saying that we ought to bring on any kind of time of trouble and be silly about this. But what's happening in our world today is what God said would happen. In this world, you shall have tribulation. And by the way, this is a dry run for what's coming. This is a warm-up. And God is calling to us through this. He's saying, hey, you know, you need to keep your wits about you now. Stay close to me. Yield your heart to me. Read and pray and pray and read. Share your faith. Get in the Word of God. The prophecies I told you about, they're true. The signs of the times are true. End time events are really going to happen. And now that they're here, we're glum. No, wait a minute. When these things begin to come to pass, lift up your head. Look up, because your redemption draweth nigh. Yes, these are the things that the prophets wrote of, that Jesus spoke of. And we can say, we're getting closer. Oh, this is a time for solemnity and sobriety, but we're getting closer. And when Jesus died on the cross, the disciples should have said, yes, that's what Jesus said would happen. We hate it, but it's what he said would happen. And we can say, amen, hallelujah, Everything's going according to plan. But they didn't say that at all. Their eyes were clouded. Their minds were darkened. Their understanding was hazy. You know, Jesus spent some time with them and broke bread, and their eyes were open, and they said, ah! The Bible says in verse 31 that he vanished out of their sight. They said one to another, didn't our heart burn within us while he talked with us, by the way, while he opened to us the scriptures? And they turned around. They just walked 7 miles. They ended up doing more than a half marathon. They turned around and went back to Jerusalem and said, the Lord indeed is risen. Isn't that something? Maybe that's what the 11 said to them. The Lord indeed is risen and has appeared to Simon. Incredible things that took place. Imagine where we'd have been without that disappointment. God took that disappointment and turned it around and brought something glorious out of it. The resurrection, the assurance that Jesus was the Messiah. Let's know that when God allows a disappointment to come, our hopes are not dashed. That's just God saying, I'm going to work out my purposes in a different way. And I wonder if you would think with me about this from God's perspective. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And what was it like? God said, very good. Then sin came. What do you think that did to God's hopes and dreams and plans? The Godhead knew from that moment sin struck that Jesus indeed would die on the cross. He was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Now Jesus would truly be the sin bearer. Now Jesus knew that his death warrant had been signed. Jesus knew that sometime in the future he would come to this earth and live as a man and die as a man out there on an old rugged cross, a cruel death. And out of the bitter disappointment of humanity's sin, God brought something beautiful. Isaiah 53 says of Jesus, he beheld of the travail of his soul and was satisfied. From ages past, Jesus looked forward and he said, I'm going to go through so much, but I'm satisfied. I'm okay. It's going to be okay because it's worth it. When humanity disappointed God so and broke God's heart, Jesus says, it'll be okay because salvation will come. I will die and be forever altered, but it'll be okay because something wonderful is going to happen for planet Earth. You see, out of disappointment comes joy. Out of darkness comes light. After the midnight, it gets even darker. But then the day breaks. And friend, we're going to see the day breaks. And I'm as disappointed as anyone. The meetings aren't going to take place in the format that we had originally designed. But they're going to take place. And you can participate from your home. Revelation today, hope awakens. You can send a link to your neighbor or your colleagues. Hey, I saw this. Maybe you'd be interested. And maybe they would. Instead of handing handbills out by 5 or 10 or 15, you can go to everybody in your inbox and say, what about this? Are you interested? Check it out. Tell me what you think. God's going to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. It's going to be bigger and it's going to be better. Well, you know what I mean by that. From sea to shining sea, we have churches participating. All across Indiana, we have churches participating. In homes, all across the Hoosier State, we'll have people participating. You know what to do. Go online and participate. Get your church involved. Be sure to watch Revelation today, Hope Awakens, on It Is Written TV, itiswritten.tv. That's where you'll find us. Join us every night. Tell people about it. This is a great time. No one believed that Earth's last days would be a picnic. People are losing money. Oh, no. I feel that. I sympathize with that. But God's going to bring something great out of it. Unfortunately, there are people right now losing jobs. That's difficult. God's going to bring something great out of this. There are a lot of sick people right now. Please pray for them. People dying. And I hope you don't think I'm minimizing this, but I'm telling you that God, out of this tremendous disappointment, is going to bring something wonderful. This is a time for great expectations. Not believing that God's not going to do what we thought he was going to do. He'll do more. He'll do greater. He's working. God doesn't take a day off. The Holy Spirit isn't asleep or dead. And as long as there's life in you, breath in your lungs, a pulse somewhere right about there, you know that God is working for you, with you, through you, for your church, in your community, in your congregation, in your family, right there on your street, in your neighborhood. God is at work. Oh, friend, we've got to be confident now because he is able. God is truly, truly able. And the best is yet to come. This is a time of great expectations. Can we look forward with hope? That poor woman had nothing. God said, you got a little oil? I'll stretch that into an oil well full of olive oil, as it were. To the widow of Nain, Jesus said, you lost your son. I'll do something great and give him right back. And you'll have a testimony to bear that will ring down through the ages. Peter, you haven't caught any fish? Oh, hold on a minute. I'm going to do something great with that catch of fish. You men and women who thought that all your hopes had died when Jesus died on the old rugged cross. Hold on. I've turned that around. I've turned defeat into victory. I've turned failure into success. You thought it was failure. Oh, no, that was success in the making. And that's where we are right now with evangelism. There's no failure. This is success in the making. How do I know that? This gospel of the kingdom, I told you before, shall be preached in all the world for a witness to all nations. And then the end will come. The gospel is going to go to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. That's what we want. We don't like the circumstances in which we find ourselves. But God is doing great things. Be encouraged today. My friends in Indiana and beyond, be encouraged today. Pastors, be encouraged today. Church leaders, be encouraged today. Conference workers and administrators, be encouraged today. God's doing truly wonderful things. I'm with you. I'm praying for you. I mean that very sincerely, praying for you. And God is with us and will always be with us. And as long as we don't forget that, we're going to be okay. What a great day when Jesus comes back. Let's pray that that day comes soon. Can we pray now? Would you pray with me? Our Father and our God, oh, it's difficult when our expectations are dashed, our hopes are crushed, our plans don't work out. But thank you in all things that you are working out your purposes. And we are jealous for your honor. We want you to be glorified. So bless us, Lord, if you would. No, wait a minute. Of course you would. Bless us, Lord, please, we pray. We celebrate your blessing and your goodness. We ask you, kind Father, to bless those in and around Indianapolis, across the great state of Indiana, who need to hear the everlasting gospel, who need to know Jesus. Bless, O Father, we pray. And thank you that we are going to see you do great things. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you for allowing me to have this time to join you. And may God richly, richly bless you. Let's look forward to April 17 and beyond with absolute confidence in our risen Savior.
He's coming soon, just a little longer. Don't be impatient. Use your time wisely. Stand firm in your faith. Endure the small things, 'cause when it's over, you'll be much stronger. It's worth the effort. Oh, hallelujah. Heaven is cheap enough. Oh, hallelujah. It's worth the effort. Oh, hallelujah. Heaven is cheap enough. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. So when the doors are shut in your face, go to another. Someone is waiting to be in invited to heaven's banquet, where they can meet their eternal family. It's worth the effort. Oh, hallelujah. Heaven is cheap enough. Oh, hallelujah. 'Cause it's worth the effort. Oh, hallelujah. Heaven is cheap enough. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Then up in heaven, Jesus will greet us. He'll say to each one, "Well done, good servant." And then we'll meet those familiar faces we helped direct to our precious Savior. 'Cause it's worth the effort. Oh, hallelujah. Heaven is cheap enough. Oh, hallelujah. It's worth the effort. Oh, hallelujah. Heaven is cheap enough. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.